I'd like to personally begin with a very, very strong personal note about Kanna and what he meant, not just for the human rights movement in general, for the legal rights movement, for accountability, speaking truth to power, if you like, when it came to judges, but particularly for many of us who were battling specifically casteism and communalism. I remember when the Sri Krishna Commission hearings were going on and the Shiv Sena BJP government decided to disband the commission. We decided to have this dharna in Bombay. That time it was Bombay, not Mumbai. And Kanna spontaneously came, not only spoke very powerfully, but then after that I was witness to this fascinating conversation between K.G.Kannabiran and H.M. Sirvai, who were as different as chalk from cheese. But because of their generation that they came from, which was gracious, compassionate and mature, they could speak with such elan to each other. And then I remember what he went through, as all of us went through in 2002 when Gujarat happened. And he was part of the concerned citizens tribunal, which was headed by Justice Krishna Iyer. But more specifically, I'd like to read this one passage he wrote for Communalism Combat after the Best Bakery judgment on April 12, 2004, specifically because of what he said in that article. When he said, what happened in Gujarat in March 2002, what happened in Mumbai in January 93, and to members of the Sikh community in 84, are genocidal trends, and courts as enforcers of international covenants ought to have taken serious note of these blatant transgressions of human rights and devised jurisprudential and procedural tools to deal with the situation. A malignant attack on lawlessness is hardly a substitute for doing justice to the wrong. A court which innovatively protected property interests, by devising the concept of prospective overruling and basic structure, could have devised a concept for disqualifying a chief minister or other ministers as having been constructively responsible for the carnage by redefining a writ of quo warranto for meeting these situations. If the Chief Minister Modi had been disqualified on the principle of constructive responsibility, rule of law would not have become the fugitive that it has become now. Bal Thackeray's Mumbai is not going to be any different. Seeing rule of law fleeing like a fugitive could invite private justice, and the terrorist may say, I shall repay. India, I think, is paying for what I believe our courts did not have the gumption to do. We still fight. The Zakia Jafri case comes up on the 23rd and 24th and 25th of November. And we've not yet given up that fight for constructive responsibility, command responsibility, but we do it in very adversarial circumstances. Vasan told me that Madurai is the city where Kanna was born, actually, because his father was stationed in the jail quarters at the time. And it was certainly the place when which he and Tarkunde were beaten up. I'd like to also say that when Tarkunde Saab's 90th birthday celebration was on, it was in a tiny little hall like this in Bombay, off Kalagoda. And there was Kanna, Tarkunde and Chandrachur on the dais. And Kanna spoke as only he can when he said that Tarkunde is one of those rare judges who actually stood on the ground and took lathis with us. And he said, I have a small recommendation to make for any judge who is appointed to the bench, particularly the higher judiciary, that before the announcement gets out that such and such a judge is appointed, she or he may be made to spend 1 24-hour in a police lockup. And only Kanna could say that and get away with it. Friends, we live in an India today which is actually, possibly for the first time, governed by a worldview that believes in the overthrow of the Indian constitution. So it's not simply one individual that one is talking about, but an entire worldview which actually then has brought out the demons in the non-state actors that attack an eklak. But eklak is just the iconic figure. There was also Latihar, where you had hangings of the kind that you had in early America, where people were hung from their tail. So I've tried in this lecture to make out what are the various challenges that are there, which stand actually very dangerously with the Supreme Court of India to decide, and what are the challenges before us is something that I will try and go into. Between 1993 and 2012, for 22 years, we published Communism Combat in print, and since 2015 November, we have now converted that into an online web portal in Southern India. Through that whole exercise, and I remember having long discussions with Bala Gopal about it, we tried forever to understand what it means to tackle the politics of the extreme social, religious, political right, and faced with an India that was also going increasingly neoliberal, so the economic right. And if ever we needed to understand how this comes together, I think we need to understand what is happening in India today. We had in December 2015 a shocking judgment from the Supreme Court when it actually upheld the Haryana Panchayat Raj law, which denied women below a certain formal education level from contesting the Panchayat elections. It was quite a shocking judgment coming as it did from the Supreme Court and actually going against the whole idea of Article 326, which is universal adult franchise, which is the hallmark of our democracy. What it means for women who are not fifth standard and seventh standard pass, and therefore they cannot contest an election. And the Supreme Court says actually that is all right, because anyway, education means civility, education means responsibility. Never mind the fact that you and I know that when it comes to communal violence, it is the educated civil who are far more brutal and far more obnoxiously hate-ridden, like the Navratri story we just heard a few minutes ago. Fortunately, a similar law was also passed in Rajasthan. And Norati Devi and Chumoto Devi have challenged this in the Supreme Court. And in the challenge, at the admitted challenge before the Supreme Court, one of the prayers is that the Haryana court order, Supreme Court order, be also struck down. So when those two finally get heard, the Supreme Court will finally decide whether universal adult franchise will be applicable in these two states or not. I believe they're testing the waters. If Haryana and Rajasthan have done it, it means that Maharashtra and Gujarat cannot be far behind. And I believe the courts do respond to public movements and public mobilizations. So I'd like to use this opportunity to say that we do not take what was attempted by Haryana and Rajasthan lightly, that the human rights movement must articulate its opposition to this narrowed conception of universal adult franchise, and we must somehow articulate the right of every woman, every man, regardless of whatever his quote-unquote education is, to be able to contest elections. I'm deliberately flagging this because I remember many journalists and writers traveling to Ayodhya in 1993 and talking to the middle class in Delhi, talking to the middle class in Bombay, talking to the middle class in Ahmedabad, and then talking to poor people who lived not far from where the Babri Mosque was demolished. And it was the poor who said that if they can demolish a mosque with such impunity, violating the law, what stops them from demolishing my home tomorrow? So the understanding of rule of law, the stake of the marginalized and the underprivileged in the rule of law and in basic rights is far higher than the middle class and the privileged. Because for the privilege, you just have to pick up a phone and find out a collector or a government official who knows you or has been in your batching since Stevens College. Because once you know that, you can get your work done. But for the vast millions who are underprivileged, it is that voting right, it is that right of the rule of law that actually ensures civility and the constitution. So this basic right of universal adult franchise, I believe, did not generate the kind of response from the rights movement that it should. And I'd like to take this opportunity to say that we need to flag this into our discourse. Several other things have happened in the last two and a half, three years. One particular thing being, or two things, three things. Soon after this man went to power in May 2014, it seemed as if the first session of parliament went by almost uncontested. There was a sense of fear, there was a sense of silence. But suddenly when he tried to get in the land acquisition ordinance, if you recall, the parliamentary opposition came together for the first time and articulated a very strong view. Now it's important to understand what the 2013 law that was brought in to right the wrongs of an 150-year-old British colonial law tried to do. It was not particularly revolutionary. It simply tried to ensure that every farmer who tills the land, every landless person who works the land, has a right to say when that land is taken away by large corporate houses, government interests, etc. So the right to actually have a veto with the Gram Panchayat was ensured through that law. Better compensation, if not ideal compensation, was ensured. And most importantly, social audit was guaranteed through the 2013 law. Suddenly you find, within 1.5 years of the 2013 law, the Modi government wanting to upturn that to a land ordinance and basically nullify some of these safeguards for our people. There was an outcry that ordinance had to be put aside. But I'm sure you're aware, but I'd like to repeat, that 3 states have subsequently passed land laws that are worse than the ordinance that was proposed in 2014. India is very big, and sometimes when I come to Tamil Nadu and Kerala, thanks to a variety of factors, not least being the prevalent Dravidian culture, I think you don't know what's happening in the West and the North. But in Rajasthan, in Maharashtra and in Gujarat, state has passed land acquisition laws which are worse than the proposed land ordinance that was sought to be passed in 2013. And these states, not coincidentally, are ruled by the RSS. I don't believe they are ruled by the BJP, I say they are ruled by the RSS. And therefore, it really means that in Gujarat, it's possible today to take over farmland despite protests and even if a Gram Sabha opposes it. In Maharashtra, it's possible to give 300 acres to Adani in the Gond forest as has been given. And we know, as all of us know, that whether it is Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, parts of Andhra, Odisha and Maharashtra, it is those areas where tribals have lived that our forests have been protected. And 300 acres of land have been given to the Adanis. It's not only that. In 2006, thanks to the People's Movement, the Forest Rights Act was passed. Thanks to the resistance from sections of the Congress Party itself, the rules for that law were not passed till 2010. 4 years it took to just get the rules passed. But thanks to the rules being passed, in many parts of the country, in tracts of land started coming back. Actually, Patta names started getting changed to the name of forest dwellers, not as Adivasis. Now, after Modi came to power, after the RSS came to power in Delhi, Javadekar, who was then education minister, issued a directive that the DM, the district collector, again has the power to veto what the Gram Sabha says when it comes to the Forest Rights Act. So through an executive order, the statutory law has been completely nullified. And there's a battle going on. There's a battle going on out there, huge contestations, but I think it needs to be part now of the mainstream human rights movement. As many of us have said before, the human rights issue is not simply about civil and political rights, but also economic and social rights. And I think we need to understand that this is where the real battle is going to be fought. Because if you saw the filing on Adivasis in Jharkhand, illegally NTPC was given land, despite the fact that the lower court and the Gram Sabha had struck it down. And yet the Jharkhand government overruled that, used the police, and 6 tribals lost their lives in the firing not less than 3 weeks ago. So there's actually a war out there. It's being staged, it's being carried out. Then there are protests. Actually, the good thing is that they're protesting. The bad thing is that thanks to the structure of the media, you and I don't get to know about the protests. So far we have social media. So far we have Facebook and social media, so we are able to collect that. But I don't know, with the kind of madness we have there, with the kind of demonetization madness that happened, tomorrow if it is decided and Facebook and social media is taken away, the ability to know what other movements are doing itself will be taken away. I did a long interview with media expert and one of our premier journalists, P. Sainath, in 2014, to understand the structure of our media, to understand how it's structured. One of the caps I wear is also that of a journalist. And he said something to me which was self-evident but frightening. Out of the 542 members of parliament we have at the moment, 83% are Karodpatis or Arabpatis, meaning they are billionaires. out of the guys who are being 83% of the 542 who are billionaires, 240, 60 belong to the ruling party and 30 odd belong to the Congress party. These billionaires are owners of telecom companies, mining companies, and television companies. So you see through this statistic a complete stranglehold on Indian democracy. Because what gets debated in parliament, how it gets debated, how it's spoken of, will get dictated then by what these members of parliament say. And hence it becomes important, I believe, that every state election also becomes today, in my mind, a human rights issue. Because in every state election, I believe today it is important that we build alliances. We build alliances so that this ideology that believes in the overthrow of the constitution at least does not get more sway in terms of our federal setup. I believe personally that's very important. The other thing that is extremely critical and before this government is the kind of labor laws and the kickback that we've seen in 150 years. On 2nd September this year, organized unions and for the first time the unorganized sector unions joined in to the organized sector unions because there have been absolute cutbacks to the gains of the labor movement that have taken place in so many years. So, it's not that UPA 1 and UPA 2 did not try to do it. We know who introduced neoliberalism in the country. But because of certain forces within the composition of the earlier UPA, there were certain pulls and pressures to make sure that there's a Security Act passed, Food Security Act passed, to make sure there's a Right to Information Act passed, to make sure there's a Forest Right Act passed. Today, you actually have a force in power that would preferably take all these rights away. That is the difference. That is the difference we're seeing. Compromises were made earlier, corruption was there earlier, black marketers were protected earlier, but you still at least had a face of it, a situation where in power was somebody, a force that believed in the Constitution. That seminal difference, I think, the human rights movement will have to grapple with, will have to make strategize about, and will have to build campaigns on. Who eats beef in the country? How many Indians eat beef? The kind of beef hysteria that we are seeing, the lynchings we are seeing, the killings we are seeing. We need to understand somewhere there also where the issues are. I dealt at length in my lecture on how between 1966 and about 2002 or 3, you had laws brought in by 7 or 8 states in the country that attempted to contested Article 38, which was a huge bone of contention between Gandhi and Ambedkar. We know about it, anybody who knows history. And we also know that Ambedkar managed to just get it stuck into the directive principles. But we also know that the cow protection laws that were brought in by the states only talked about the killing of the cow, but did not actually expand it further and kept it at a very narrow definition. Fortunately, right up to 2003, 2004, 2005, you had Supreme Court judgments that upheld that. But what we see post 2003-4, and then you see what happens politically in India between 1999 and 2004, you see the Supreme Court judgments slightly opening up and giving greater leeway to the Gujarat kind of law, which allows for a more wider interpretation and easier lynching of people on the ground. Soon after this government came to power in Delhi and in Maharashtra, Maharashtra passed a law similarly. It was immediately challenged by many people, individuals and groups. And Maharashtra High Court actually has struck it down and now the constitutional challenge lies before the Supreme Court. I believe this too is an issue that the human rights movement cannot ignore. It's a matter of cultural rights, it's a question of protein for the vast sections of our poor, it's a question of freedom of choice, and it is inherent to fundamental rights and a democracy. One aspect which is not here, but which I want to repeat because I got to know about this yesterday when I had this fascinating discussion with Justice Anipatnam when he was at the function yesterday. And he was, I was talking about my lecture. 1966 under Indira Gandhi, a cow protection committee was set up at the national level. And no less than Goivalkar was asked to head it, representing as he did the RSS. And even Golwalkar came to the conclusion in 1966 that it's not possible to ban, to have a cow protection law all over India, because India is too vast, India is too different, there are beef-eating parts, there is part of a culture. So I think all of these aspects of history, politics, law, on the issue of beef, on the issue of freedom of choice, on the issue of killing and lynching, need to be taken up in a big way. I know in Tamil Nadu it has become an issue. You've had beef festivals, you've had, in Hyderabad you've had them, but in Western India it's very difficult to even conceive of something like a beef festival. It's not possible. In fact, a friend of mine, Amir, recently narrated a very funny story to me, because he makes very macabre things look very funny. When he said he was traveling by train recently, and he sat in this compartment and suddenly saw somebody opposite him, who more obviously looked like a Muslim because he was wearing a cap. And they were both looking and looking around at everybody else and thinking whether to pick up a difference to eat or not. And suddenly they took out something, and then obviously the smell of a very good kebab filled the air. So once that happened, the second dog and the third box also came out and everybody ate very fast. So this is the kind of fear that people are dragging in chains in. This is the kind of fear that people are actually in the cities with. In Maharashtra itself, despite the High Court having struck down what was a draconian provision, the police is still harassing traders who import beef from other states. So there's a consensus which is building up outside the law. There's a consensus which is being manufactured, in fact, outside the law. And this is what I think somehow the human rights movement needs to factor in, and we need to be in there. There are so many things that need to be spoken about, and I would like to also speak about one very important challenge that lies before the Supreme Court at this moment, in which some of us have sought to intervene. It is a very critical issue, which is the issue of the interpretation of the Representation of People's Act, Article 123, and to what extent should religion have a place in the electoral process. Now it's very strange, because when I mentioned Kanna coming down to Bombay in 1992-93, long before Gujarat had started monitoring from about 1989 onwards, when I first wrote about the textbooks there, and Maharashtra from about the mid-80s is when Shiv Sena decided to make Maharashtra a project for the Hindu Rashtra, for Hindutva, etc. And you saw a spate of local elections, assembly elections and local elections, in which vitriol and venom was spilled on the streets. Literal vitriol and venom. And so you chose, because of the vitriol and venom, you saw a spate of petitions, election petitions, challenging the election of several candidates, coming up before the High Court between 1985-86 and about 1991-92. Spate of petitions. It was Ramesh Prabhu, Subhash Desai, Manohar Joshi, all the Shiv Sena leaders' elections were challenged by different competing candidates. Interestingly, because I think you can't look at the courts without looking at mass politics and look at the influence of mass politics on our courts, spate of judgments that came out of Bombay High Court were unanimous in bitterly critiquing this incursion of electoral politics by a particular brand of vitriolic religion, and they were very clear in what they said. Different judges gave those judgments. I hate to speak in that language of deconstructing the identity of a judge, but except for our very own Justice Suresh, three of the judges who gave those judgments belong to the Parsi minority community. Justice Variyava, Justice Bharucha, and Justice Suresh were the ones who delivered those judgments in Bombay. Those judgments went to the Supreme Court. And the famous or the infamous Hindutva judgment is the result of the challenge from the High Court. Strange things often happen in the Supreme Court, as we know. The judges, strange things happen with good judges. That's the even bigger tragedy. And I don't want to get into who did what, but the fact remains is that in the Supreme Court, when a particular case was being heard, one particular case, the Ramesh Prabhu case, observation was made about Hindutva and Hinduism being a way of life, which has been shamelessly appropriated by the Bharatiya Janata Party in three manifestos after that. They quote from the Supreme Court judge. Now, importantly, it's important for activists to know that the same Supreme Court, once before and once after this Prabhu judgment, by a similar bench of three judges, actually ruled the exact opposite on Hindutva. Exact opposite. Saying that it actually does mean a corrupt practice under 123. But that obviously is not part of the manifesto. And that obviously is not what the impact on the ground is. And that's where I think all of us and mass politics fails in a way, because something is picked and chosen. And that is why, apart from an overall interpretation of 123.3, this particular passage of this particular judgment is also up for review in the reference before the Supreme. Now, the overall reference is as important, not just this particular panel. The overall reference is actually maybe even more important, because 123.3 section of the law basically talks about a candidate and his or her invoking religion in the electoral arena. Through the arguments that went on for 3 weeks in the Supreme Court, the BJP and the Shiv Sena Council were arguing that when a candidate talks about his or her religion, it's only about the religion of his or her, of the candidate. It does not mean religion per se. It does not mean what is contained in the party manifesto. It does not mean the religion of the voter. It does not mean the religion of the opposing. Completely defies all logic, and they were grilled in open court on that. So, potentially, before the Supreme Court, now the arguments are closed, it's up for judgment anytime soon. Potentially, if there is a sound or a profound reading of 123.3, that could at least render some of the open vitriol in the electoral arena completely clarified. What the bench has indicated so far is that the Hindutva paragraph will not be looked at by this judgment, this bench, but will be referred to a 5-member bench. We urge that should not be 20 years later. Let's see what they do. Point being that very critical issues of secular democracy, republican democracy, the foundations of our constitution, today lie with our courts. And at the end of the day, when things lie with our courts, we all are activists here who work with the courts, who go sometimes to the court as a last resort after other mobilizations fail. We must understand that we can only succeed if there's also a mass mobilization around that issue. It's not possible to get justice in the abstract without some sort of educated, informed mobilization being created around some of the issues. And that is a real challenge. I went through about 800 judgments from 1905 onwards on the issue of 123.3. And the line is quite clear. We have an amendment in 1951, which in one sense broadened the definition. But the general appreciation by the court was very clear about when it became malignant and when it did not. By and large, there is clarity. The confusion happens in these 5 years in three judgments. Otherwise, the line of judgment is reasonably clear about what they say. And it is these three judgments that have been openly and shamefully misused in manifestos. Interestingly, the BJP also tried to argue in the Supreme Court that, you know, if you were to take away religion from politics altogether, which nobody was arguing, then what happens to a pogrom? BJP was arguing. What happens when there's a victim of a pogrom or a minority community? Can they not talk about justice? Can they not talk about getting justice in an election? And that was actually countered not just by us, but also by the judges, saying that there's a constitutional guarantee for the marginalized sections. And there's a constitutional guarantee that these fundamental rights gives you. And that you invoke during an election, that is not an offense. It is only when you use religion to, in fact, subsume that fundamental right that it is. So the distinction was quite clear, but there was a lot of obfuscation going on. Challenge then cannot be only in the courts. Challenge is on the ground. In Gujarat, as was referred to by an earlier speaker, you had the Una incident on July 8th take place, after which huge amount of resentment build up among our Dalit brothers and sisters. Not just a resentment and a movement, but also a concrete demand for land, which rarely happens after there's an incident of such atrocity. And for many of us who've been working in Gujarat for many, many years, what was as important as the agitation that Dalits had was the almost spontaneous and magical coming together of Dalits and Muslims. It was almost waiting to happen. And on July 27th and 28th, 2 days running, when our Dalit friends actually took out a rally in Narurapatia, which was the site of the worst, possibly the worst carnage of worst incident of 2002, where 126 people were killed in broad daylight. Daylight rape, women instigating men to rape young girls and women in Ahmedabad city. In that Narurapatia, in daylight, Dalits actually carried out a processions talking about Dalit Muslim unity. And I spent time the next 3 days talking to our survivor sisters who had testified in the courts, and all of them, without question, had tears in their eyes. And they said, we don't know what is happening actually, but we somehow feel that they're trying to say sorry. Now, these are very rare moments, I believe, in public life. They don't happen easily. They cannot be constructed. They cannot be planned. And I think if they happen, they happen because of something happening at a very, very grassroots level, which all of us in some way have been trying to contribute to, but one is seeing that. Friends, since 2002, 68 cases reported. 68 cases right from the trial court up to the Supreme Court down, up and down. We managed to get 137 minus 14, because recently the High Court acquitted 14 persons, convicted to life imprisonment. It was very deeply important to us and our group and our lawyers and our entire team that we somehow convinced the survivors not to ask for death penalty. But it was not easy. It meant long conversations. It meant persuading people as to why it's important to have life imprisonment and not death penalty as a matter of principle. Because in Gujarat and anywhere else, it's very easy to talk about retribution. And Godhra had been given, the Godhra accused had been given death penalty in February 2008. So then how do you, and all our trials were being heard when that judgment came, and yet we persuaded them that we should ask for death penalty. I think that was a really important victory for us, beyond the numbers that you get convicted. Because I think it sends a sentiment, it conveys a message, you put it in arguments, you convey a message in your neighborhood that what you're looking for is not killing somebody or the death of somebody, but actually just an acknowledgement that what happened was profoundly wrong and should never be repeated. I realized when we were fighting this battle how horribly imbalanced our system is. If you or I, a survivor or a human rights organization, PUCL or anybody else, goes to the court, any paper that you file in the court, even in the Supreme Court, every line is viewed with suspicion. If you go wrong on even minutest detail, you will suffer for it. And you will suffer humiliation for it. You will be castigated, which the media will blow up, etc. Friends, through this struggle in Gujarat, I'm sure you've also been witness to it, there have been occasion and occasion when affidavit officers of the court have lied. They've given wrong figures to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court has passed an order saying that the Gujarat officers are misleading us. But no action, no remark, no reprimand. And that officer does not suffer. I'm not talking about the vilification campaign against us. That's another story as to how much they've lied there. I don't want to waste precious minutes here on that. I'm talking about on how many people, we argued, for instance, in the Supreme Court, that how come the Godhra accused did not get bail till they got acquitted or convicted in 2011, and all the post-Godhra, except for Dalits, criminal line notified tribes, those accused who had no political godfather in the VHP or RSS, 60-70% of the post-Godra accused, whether they are Patels, whether they are Kotnani, whether they are Bajrangi, anybody, got bail within 3 months of the carnage, 6 months of the carnage. And even sometimes the Sessions Court refused the bail, but the High Court runs. So it's not that the higher courts are always the better courts. Huh? Let's not say that. We say that very easily sometimes. So, inaccuracies by a survivor, human rights group, citizens group, even if it's made in the, because you have no respect, look at the resources the state has. Each time we have a hearing in the Supreme Court, you just have to look at the appearance list in the Supreme Court. You have at least 25 lawyers on the other side. And on our side, we're the same four valued names who've been there for the last 15 years. Same five, same six maybe, same three sometimes. So that they can stand in for each other. But on the other side, you had a battery of big names. Sometimes judges' sons and daughters, carefully hired by the Gujarat state, to just ensure that nothing goes terribly wrong. It's so easy in this country to manipulate a system if the state is privileged. I remember one more thing. We had victories like the Best Bakery judgment, the Bilkis Bano judgment, which Gagan and others were responsible for. We had victories like the Naroda Patia judgment and the Sardarpura judgment. But what is critical is that some of this happened because there was a whole political and public atmosphere of revulsion about what had happened in Gujarat. And the Supreme Court was persuaded in that situation to continue with the writ of continuing mandamus. If it had stopped monitoring the cases, it would have been very difficult. It would have been very difficult. I also discovered through this entire journey how much depends on that judge sitting in the chair. Because in our adversarial system, where you're trying to get convictions for mass crimes, and a bakery worker who's not educated in the formal sense, but who's perfectly technologically equipped because he knows how to cook a curry biscuit. And I don't know if you know a curry biscuit, but curry biscuit in Bombay and Gujarat is very popular. You can only make a curry biscuit if you have a complete knowledge of what temperature to put your biscuit into and when to take it out. So his technologically and engineering skills are all there. But he's standing in the Masgar court to identify accused who had killed 14 people. And on the other side, in the defense, you have six lawyers who will be cross-examining one man and battering him down, abusing him, bullying him with their tone, insulting his poverty and his lack of social niceties. That's when I realized, because I sat in the court day after day, Best Bakery and Naroda Patia, I realize how much in our system depends on the temperament of the judge. Tipse in the Masgaon case, Best Bakery case, and Jyotsna Yagnik in the Naroda Patia case. They were unflappable. They knew a political drama was being played out outside and inside the court. In Naroda Patia, in Ahmedabad, every day the accused would threaten our lawyers inside the court. This woman was unflappable. Our survivor sisters would stand up and weep and speak about what they had gone through, what their sisters and daughters had gone through in terms of gender violence. Never has it happened before in the history of jurisprudence that gender narrative of gender violence comes back during a trial. It did during the Naroda case. And if you read that 2000-page judgment, it's a study in how she deals with our current witness and eyewitness. She says that so many years later, these women are standing and they are weeping because they are recounting what happened in their mind. And each time that they were trying to recount this, they were being badgered by the other side. But she sort of cocooned them with dignity and allowed them to speak. You realize it's not just about justice in the abstract sense. It depends on the compassion, the ability and the humanity of the church. And therefore, I think when we speak about representative justice, sections of society get very upset. They don't understand what that means. When we say for the women's movement that there should be more women judges, it's not just women per se, because you can have a woman like Meenakshi Lekhi also. But we're not talking about that. We're talking about something that represents that when a survivor of gender violence is speaking and having to recount because of our system the indignities which no person should have to recount in public, she's allowed to do it with some degree of humanity and dignity. But that's not what the court allows it. I believe also that we need to demand CCTVs. We must demand CCTVs in the courtroom. I remember when the Gulberg trial was being heard. And one judge, exact opposite, monitored by Supreme Court, exact opposite of these two that I just gave the examples of, looks at Saira Ben and does this and says, does she look as if she lost a son? Open court. And the accused are sitting at the back. And every time he would make a statement, he'd be looking straight at the accused and smiling. Open court. I believe there should be CCTVs in courtrooms, so that the higher courts can actually see what's happening when a trial takes place. And when a woman, a Dalit, marginalized, a laborer, standing up for justice, how our people are treated in the so-called temples of justice. These are some of the lessons one has learned. These are some of the future battles that we need to fight. I hope that we can somehow factor this together into our human rights movement. I want to end because of what was said about the Navratri. I just want to end with a small episode that I first reported on in 1991 in Gujarat. Before we started Communism Combat, I was in Business India magazine, and I said I'd started covering Gujarat from 1989 onwards. And every July when there's a Rath Yatra, you have violence. And I remember particularly being very disturbed in the post-1986 period. If you remember, there was also, Vasant will know, there was a schism in our feminist movement also. Because many of us felt that because of the Shravan case and certain paradigms that were being set by the extreme right like the RSS and the BJP, the women's movement was not being able to understand and being able to see how the right wing was appropriating the language of the women's movement. So for instance, a few of us talked about it. Urvashi Kutalia was one, I was one. We kept talking about this because I saw with my own eyes women turn against women during communal violence. I had never seen that before. 84, you couldn't see it. 91, you could see it. I mean, I witnessed actually in Machimanagar in Bali how a fisherwoman, not upper caste, not privileged, but actually beating with a lathi of pregnant Muslim women in Benin. And that's not something you want to see. That tells you what has been breached by the politics of the far right. So much has been breached. So coming back to 91, I remember one of the worst incidents I saw, and I reported in Business India. That time the VHP would distribute maps to us, journalists. And the map was orange and green, basically telling us that this part of Ahmedabad should never become green. And what was that part? That was that side of the bridge. The new Ahmedabad, the satellite, the Navrangpura. They wanted Muslims and Dalits to be confined to the old city. But Gujus being Gujus, today the old city is where the real estate is, all the hotels and the havelis are coming up. So today the old city has become glamorous for them. Gujaratis adapt very quickly for money. But at that time we had this map which was given to us. And one particularly awful incident was in Narangpura, which is a part of Posh Ahmedabad, where a family, and I remember he was with IOC, one Mr. Khan, living on the second floor of a building, and two buxom Gujarati women had picked him up at the height of the violence and thrown him to his death from the second floor. The message was clear that you cannot move and live out of your ghettoized existence. I was recalling this 2 months ago in Nagpur. I was recounting an incident like this. Somebody had asked me to deliver a lecture in Nagpur and I was talking about this incident. After the lecture got over, you won't believe what happened. A Times of India journalist came up to me and he was in tears and said, "Can I talk to you separately?" I said, "Sure." He said, "Can I add the last part of the story that you narrated?" He said, "I was in standard 10 at that time. I lived in Narayanpura. And the Navratri of the July that you're talking about, those women were felicitated in public for killing that man." The story doesn't end. It's also about ghettoization. It's also about mixed communities. So many challenges we face to be able to texture and labor and this thing, our rights movement, to actually make it meaningful in the India of today. There's so many other things I can share with you, but I think I've already way overstepped the time that has been granted. I hope you have the time and patience to go through this lecture. And I'll only end by saying that I hope this becomes another reason for all of us, so many friends in the audience, to not just keep meeting, but to rejuvenate ourselves, to maybe redefine how the right struggle should go, even though the questions involved are so deeply political. Thank you.